thank God for this privilege. I know I can't sing, but I'm gonna make a noise.
Sing on, honey, sing on.
Don't he? He didn't want this song to be today. Lord, it's just another hill that I'm climbing. Lord, it's just another tear you'll wipe away. If I can just hold on a little longer, I'll be rejoicing. Every burden seems to weigh a little more, and every river seems to be a little wider, but I know I'm getting closer to home. Lord, it's just another hill that I'm Lord, it's just another tear you'll wipe away. If I can just hold on a little longer, oh, I'll be rejoicing in heaven someday.
Amen.
Got you. Red books, turn to page 35. I want to hear some singing today. Since Jesus came into my heart.
Jesus came in.
Take me to my heart. But I'm throwing all my soul like the sea that was strong. Dear Jesus, take me to my heart. I'm a saint on the whole that is saved. I said, sure, dear Jesus, take me to my heart. And oh, Lord, welcome down in my heart. Why, I'm sure that Jesus came into my heart. That Jesus came into my heart. That Jesus came into my heart.
Yeah. 29. There ain't none of us want to make this world their home, do we? Sometimes, Brother Charles. I just want to go on and be with him. Praise God.
My treasures are
3:14.
Oh.
with that one, since Charles won't sing that song for me.
I don't know what to sing.
I want to speak to you today about the blood. If I had them, I like to try to title my messages so that it helps people's minds. So I titled this one "Seeing Red." It will be coming out of the book of Exodus, the 12th chapter. Start out with reading one verse, and that is verse 13 of chapter 12. Chapter 12, verse 13 reads and says, "And the blood shall be to you for a token unto the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt." The title of this message today, "Seeing Red," because red is the color of blood. Of course, we all know that. But in order to be a Christian and to be saved and to be set apart, we have to have the blood applied. Jesus said in the scripture that when he sees the blood, that he would pass over the house and not suffer the destroyer to come in and to attack and to kill those that was behind the blood or that the blood was applied to, which we'll see here later on how he instructed them to apply the blood. This in this scripture is talking, yes, physically to an earthly dwelling, but I want you to listen to it in your mind and think about it on a spiritual matter, because today, the time and the day that we're living in, Brother Jeff, we've got to be living in the spiritual side and not in the physical realm, amen, if we're going to make it to heaven, because Jesus' blood is the only way. God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And how is that? By following his leading, his teaching, his guiding of his Holy Ghost, and making sure that when he went to that cross some 2,000 years ago and shed his blood, that it is applied to your heart and your life every day. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I believe we're living in a day and an hour where we need to start bringing out more preachings and more teachings on the blood and on the cross. Because without the blood being applied, you're going, you're lost, and you're dying in the world. It's going to send you straight to the devil's hell. Amen?
Right.
I can look around, and we can look around and look outside our doors, and we can see signs of time coming to pass day after day after day. But the church sits idly by. Why is it? I believe it's because, Brother Charles, over half of the church don't have the blood applied. They have what seemeth to be a right way, which is just a form of religionist religion and denying the power thereof.
Right?
Amen.
What I mean by having a form of religion and denying the power thereof, it means they think because they show up to church, because they throw their tithes and their offering in an offering plate, they think that they're all right, but they're lacking the one thing, and that was the precious blood of Jesus Christ that he shed on the cross so that you and I could have life and we could have it more abundantly.
Amen.
If you'll go back up to verse 5 here, Exodus 12, it reads and it says, "Your lamb." This is where God was speaking to Moses, telling him how to do it in the physical here.
Yeah.
He said, "Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. ye shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats. When we see the word lamb here, these are things just that when I read this, that the Lord began to pop out to me and show me in a spiritual mind of speaking, if you will. When we see the word lamb without blemish, a male of the first year, when we look at it spiritually, that's talking about Jesus Christ. He was the firstborn son of God through the Virgin Mary. He was the only begotten son is what the Bible calls him. So he was the firstborn male. Amen? He was the perfect lamb sacrifice. He was the one without spot and without blemish. To you and I in a physical / spiritual world. But in this sense, he was talking about taking a physical goat or a physical sheep. Amen. The Bible says that Christ is our shepherd. Glory to God, that he is the shepherd of you and us. He's the lamb, if you will. Exodus chapter 12. Going down to verse 17, it goes on and it says this. It says, "And ye shall observe the feast of unleavened bread. For in this selfsame day I have brought your enemies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore shall I observe this day in your generation by an ordinance forever." The word Egypt that we see here. When I see that, the words that come to me was Egypt being that which holds you captive or bondage. Because we see the reason why that Egypt to me is something that holds you captive or bondage is because it was the Egyptians. It was Pharaoh that kept the children of Israel under captivity and bondage for over 400 years. Amen. And there's things that's in the life of people today that have the religion and not the blood applied that is holding them captive, that's holding us in bondage because we don't want to let it go. It's like was spoken earlier. We say that if it's all right in the dark, nobody else will know that it's fine. But God said that he has an all-seeing eye.
Amen.
Come on. Oh, I'm plowing some rocky ground today for some reason.
Come on.
Amen. Somebody help me a little bit. But through the blood of Jesus, he will bring you out. It's only the blood of Jesus that's going to take us through, sis. It's only the blood of Jesus that's going to bring us out. There's a song that said, that is something that says he's going to bring me out of this dusty desert where it's so dusty and dry, amen? Well, how's he going to do it? If we have the blood applied and we listen intently to his voice and follow his every command and every instruction. What if back in the days when Solomon built the temple, what if he decided not to follow every single divine instruction that God had given him in the building and the preparing of it? It would have failed. But you know what? That's why God and the Holy Ghost and his Son Jesus has stayed for years and years upon years and generation past generation compared to everything else that has come on a whim, a spare of the moment, fly by night thing in this world, because it was built upon a divine ordinance that God has set forth.
Amen.
There's a proper way that a church should be run. There's a proper way that you and I as children of God are to conduct ourselves. And if we don't conduct God's house and ourselves in these divine orders, then we don't have the blood applied. We're what is called, and I've heard it several times, self-made preachers, self-made churches, self-made teachers.
Self-made religion, come on.
Amen.
Said, Brother Valentine, that's hard. We're living in hard times. It calls for hard, drastic measures. One of those hard, drastic measures is following the Word of God from with every I dotted and every T crossed. Not because we come across the Scripture that we don't like, we don't tear it out and throw it. like so many have done.
Right.
We got to find ourselves back to the foot of the cross. Paul said it best when he said, I die daily. What did that mean? That tells me that Paul, on a daily basis, went back and met Jesus at the foot of the cross and reapplied the blood of Jesus Christ. You see, this thing ain't just a mamby-pamby game. It's a choice. We're not forced into being saved with salvation. It's a choice. We've got to make that choice. Brother Charles, whether we're going to, when we wake up in the morning, whether before our feet hit the floor, we're going to serve God or we're going to serve man.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen. Praise God.
Exodus 12 and 19 says, 7 days shall there be no leaven found in your houses. For whosoever eateth that which is leavened, even that soul shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he be a stranger or born in the land. Again, when I seen the word leaven, we all know what leaven is. The Bible talks about too much leaven. Leaven is the whole lump. Well, let's think about it spiritually. If you put too much leaven in bread, and it's going to cause it to rise the whole lump way too much. That's the way it is with sin in our life. I picture that leaven being sin, brother. There's too much sin in the camp anymore in today's churches. Not only in this area of the country, but all over. They have become self-help preachers and teachers and have gotten out of the Word of God. They begin to speak and to teach and to preach what is supposed to be politically correct and not worried about what God says is right.
Amen. Amen.
Blood has better be applied, or I'm here to tell you, when you stand before God in judgment, you'll find your eyes opening up in hell.
Right.
Amen.
Again, the leavening would be sin. Amen. False doctrine. False teachings. It says in verse 19, it says, for whosoever eateth that which is leavened. When we can say when we see this that sin, that the leaven is the sin that we partake of. And the Bible says that if you eat of that leaven during that 7 day here, he said that they would be cut off from the land. Cut off. I believe God is coming to a time that God's about to cut some church folk off because they are dibbling in so much leaven, brother, that their lump is so lumpy that there's no way in the world you can beat it with a ball, hammer, or anything to get the lumps out.
Yep. Amen.
Preaching to the nail.
Come on.
Come on, brother.
It says, so shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he be stranger or born in the land. The congregation, if we look at it on a spiritual note, at that time it was talking about the body of Israel. Today it's talking about God. If we don't get the sin out of the church house, out of the pulpits, out of our lives, and start looking back to the foot of the cross, we will be cut off. And when I say cut off, I'm talking about cut off from the kingdom of God. When the Lord comes back to take us to the place that he said that he has went prepared for you and I.
Yep.
Amen.
We'll never see that kingdom. We'll never enter into the joys of the Lord. Exodus 12 and 21. Then Moses called for all of the elders of Israel, and he said unto them, draw out and take you a lamb according to your families, and kill the Passover. The Passover here, spiritually speaking, is Jesus Christ. See, they didn't understand it back when the church went in secret and into the garden. And they took Jesus and they sought counsel against him. And then Pilate, when they brought him to Pilate, Pilate told him after two times of speaking to him, he found no fault in him to take him and do what you want. And washed his hands of it in a basin of water. They didn't realize then that they was taking the perfect lamb that was without spot and without blemish and was about to drive nails through his hands and feet and put on a purple robe and a crown of thorns and crown the King of Kings and Lord of Lords of the man that can take us to see God. Glory to God. Church, if nobody in here is saved, I'm having to plow harder than I should.
Amen.
Plow, son, with a shower, not preach.
The Passover here, spiritually speaking again, was Jesus Christ. Exodus 12 and 22. And ye shall take a bunch of hyssops and dip it in the blood that is in the basin and strike the lintel and the two side posts and the blood that is in the basin, and none of it shall go out at the door of his house until the morning. Now this is where you get into the part where God instructed them that they were to take the blood after sacrificing that lamb without spot and blemish. They were supposed to take that blood and dip brushes, if you will, into it like a paintbrush. And it was to paint the lintel, which is the top of the door. They was to paint the two side door posts.
Yeah.
And he went on and he told them that if you'll do all of these things just as I have instructed, when I send the destroyer through the land of Egypt, when I see the blood that is across the lintel and down the doorpost, I will pass over you.
Yeah.
Come on.
Amen.
Come on.
There's coming a day that the destroyer is fixing to come again. And if the blood is not applied to our lintel and our doorpost, he will not suffer that destroyer to pass over us. See, when we read about that blood that was put across the lintel and the two doorposts, although it was physical at this time, to us today it's spiritual. We're talking about Jesus' blood that was shed on the cross some 2,000 years ago.
Read verse 23 there.
For the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians. And when he seeth the blood,
yeah.
upon the lintel and on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer the destroyer to come. Come in unto your house to smite you. Church, I'm telling you, and if you ever listen by Facebook or YouTube, if you ain't got the blood of Jesus Christ applied to your spiritual lintel and doorpost, I'm telling you now is the time to get it applied and to quit playing church. We just dealt with a young man that had been playing church here just last week, and my heart goes out to him. Because he knows right from wrong.
Yep.
He knows what he was doing. But I'm telling you, he's playing church. He was playing church just like most others are playing church today.
Yep.
Well, what do you mean playing church, Gilbert? I mean, you come to the house of the Lord and you act the act and you look the look and you dress the part in front of Christian folk, but behind closed doors when you think nobody's looking, the true blue you comes out rising. The Bible says what is in the man's heart, so it will come out.
Amen.
It says out of the abundance of the heart, so does the mouth speak.
Amen. Yeah.
Well, you sound like these stiff-necked holiness, Pastor Gilbert. It ain't got nothing to do with stiff-necked holiness. It's got to do with this is what God's Word says. Those stiff-necked holiness, it's all about the dress and about the look. A lot of them had better get down on their knees and find out what the true blood of Jesus Christ is to begin with. Because to them it's all about the look, all about the persona, but everything else about the love of Jesus Christ and the compassion and everything else has went out the door. Because if you don't look their look and walk their walk and talk their talk, then you're not saved.
Amen.
They don't even want you to darken their door. And the reason why a lot of that is because they've gotten up the church. The church has gotten away from the cross. They've gotten away from preaching the blood. They've got away from preaching hellfire and brimstone like they did in the days that I grew up. And they said, well, in those days they was just doing it to scare the folks to stay in church. Well, if it takes a little bit of scaring with reality, then I say let's scare them. I pray the Lord would anoint me one day to preach a message on hell. Brother Charles, it's so hot and so heavy that they can smell the smoke and feel the heat. If that's what it will take to bring somebody back to Christ, or to bring a sinner that's never known Christ to Christ, or a backslider who's known Christ and then turned his back on Christ, back to Christ.
Yeah.
Because we're living in a day and time that this song they used to sing, wait a little longer, please Jesus. They ain't much longer. And I don't believe God is going to tarry much longer for us to sing that song, wait a little longer, please Jesus, until I get my loved ones in.
Come, Lord Jesus. Come on. Come on.
See, Jesus' blood was shed for our sin, for our eternal life. But the only way that blood works is if we'll come crawling to the foot of the cross and we kneel down at the foot of the cross of Jesus, and with an honest heart we give him our all in all and give him everything and say, God, here is my life. My life is not my own. To you I belong, as the worship song goes. That's what God is looking for. Church, he's coming. He says, I'm coming back. After church, without spot or blemish.
Amen.
I know there's actual church names that when they read it, they think that they're talking, that God's talking about just their church or their organization or their denominations. But I got a busty bubble. You ain't the church. The name over the door is not the church.
Right.
The church is you and I, each individual.
Amen.
We make up the body of Christ, no matter what the name, organization, or denomination over the door is.
Amen.
I got news for you folks that think when you get to heaven there's going to be sections for each denomination. Because I've got news for you. There's not going to be no segregation in heaven. My Charles, there's not going to be no segregation. There's not going to be no Baptist, Methodist, Catholic, Pentecostal, Holiness, Presbyterian, a Church of Nazarene. It's going to be one body and one mind and one accord. And if you're not one of those people spiritually, physically and spiritually now, then you're not going to be that person spiritually over there. Because you'll never make it.
Amen.
You'll never make it further than the gates of hell.
Amen.
Come on.
John chapter 19, if you want to go there, you can.
Thank you, John.
Yeah. I'm going to try my best to bring this to a close, but I can't make no promise. Whatever the Lord leads. Sis, do you have the song, "I'm Too Worthy, Lord, to Come to You"? I want you to sing that when I'm through. We're going to actually do an altar call this morning. John chapter 19, verse 17 and verse 18 says, "And he, bearing his cross, went forth unto the place called the place of the skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two others with him, one on either side." On either side, one, and Jesus in the midst. Now the word door. I messed something. Got to go all the way up to 9. That's what I thought. Verse 9 here. That's like the devil, but that's all right. I'll just tell you about it.
About
10
and
9? 10 or 10 and 9. There we go. That's where I'm messing up. Chapter 19, verse 17 and 18 was the telling us about Christ and how he went up to be crucified. So chapter 10 and 9. And this is Christ speaking. He says, "I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pastures. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that thou might have life, and that they may have it more abundantly." Again, verse 9 says, "I am the door. By me." By me. "If any man enter, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture." The word door here is Jesus Christ. Jesus was telling his disciples in chapter 10 here that he was the way, he was the truth, he was the life. Through him is how anybody gets to the Father.
He's the only door for salvation.
He's the only door
for salvation,
amen?
He's the only way into the church.
He's the only way into the church, into the sheepfold. He's the only way to make it into heaven. At one point he told his disciples, he said, "In a little while you see me, in a little while you know." He said, "Because I go and prepare a place for you, that where I am you may be also."
Amen.
Well, how do we get where he is also? It's by going to the foot of the cross and applying on a daily basis the blood of Jesus Christ to our heart, to our lintel, to our doorpost. Amen.
Amen. That's daily.
He gives us a daily choice to serve and follow him, or to follow the devil and his minions. Those these folk that holler, "Well, I went down in Jesus' name, I got saved, so I'm always saved," I got news for you. You better read your word.
Right.
Amen.
Are you saying you don't believe one saved, always saved? No. But yes. Because if you get saved and you daily apply the blood, then you're going to stay saved.
Amen.
And that's the only way. But if you get saved and that's as far as it goes, you don't seek out the Word of God for wisdom and knowledge, and you don't go to the cross on a daily basis, you're going to stumble, you're going to fall, you're going to backslide, and if you die in that state, you'll open your eyes in hell.
Amen.
Since the problem with the church, Brother Charles, the church, the only time they open their Bible and the only time they pray and the only time their brain is in gear to think about God and heaven and hell is when they walk through a church door or when they pass a fellow church brother or sister. It's not going to make it. That's not going to cut it.
Or when they got a problem, they use God as a spare tire.
Yeah. Or when they have a problem and they use God as a spare tire. You know, God, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost is not some kind of food that you can stick in a mason jar and put it in a hot boiling bath, water bath, and can it up and seal it to keep it fresh until you want Him and until you need Him. Have you ever seen a pond that water quit running into? That pond begins to stagnate.
Yep.
But as long as there's a fresh, steady stream of water running into this pond or this creek or this river, it does not go stagnant. I'm afraid so many people that have sat in the church house, in the pews, and have grown stagnant on God because they only hear about Him, they only read about Him, they only pray to Him when they're dark in the church house door. And they wonder why their life is in the shambles and the wreck that it's in.
They don't do that third convenience. Come on.
Glory to God. And the 23rd verse of Exodus there that of chapter 12 that Dad had me read. The word destroyer that we see here is the enemy.
Amen.
Today is the enemy.
Yep.
See, the blood has not been applied to a lot of folks' lives since it says I'm Christian.
Amen.
Well, what's Christian mean?
Christ-like.
It means Christ-like. No, we're not going to be perfect as Christ was because we're human, we're flesh. But He says we can have an applicant with the Father when we stumble and fall, and He'll forgive us and He'll bring us and move us up and help us to overcome whatever it was that caused us to stumble and fall there so that we don't do it again.
Amen. Can't keep going back, good.
No. But if you have the blood applied and you have entered at the door and no other way, then all the enemy can do is press. All he can do, Charles, is press. Well, what do you mean, Pastor Valentine? I mean, all he can do is try to entice and try to tempt. But he can't make you do anything. He can't make you choose a choice that you don't want to choose. Just like God is not going to make you choose the choice that you don't want to choose to follow Him. But the enemy loves to press. And how does he love to press? No, he didn't flatten my tire on the way to church so I couldn't go to church. That's hogwash. But he presses right here, Brother Jeff. He loves to play the mind games. What do you mean by play mind games? Trying to get you to think that your sister that's sitting next to you has got an issue with you and is mad and don't like you. Trying to make you think that the pastor don't care about you because he might not have shook your hand this morning.
Come
on.
Yep.
Man.
I tell you, some of the church remind me of that old song Ray Stevens sung, the day the squirrel went to church.
Oh,
here it is, supposed to be a church house full of Christian folk, and it took a squirrel and a false anointing to get the preacher saved and the deacon saved and a bunch of them filled with the Holy Ghost. Talk about the thief that cometh in the night. Bible says he comes for to kill, steal, and to destroy. But he said, I come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly.
Amen.
He said, I am the good shepherd, and the shepherd giveth his life for the sheep.
Yep.
How many folk in here did the devil give his life for you? How many folk out yonder that be watching this by Facebook or YouTube, did the devil give his life for you? Did he shed his blood for you?
Amen.
Let me tell you something. Only thing the devil did was get all high and mighty and thought he was going to take over. So what once was the most beautiful archangel in charge of music and praise and worship in heaven, God took and he felt fit to boot him out. Which is what he's about to do to half of the folks in this world today, Brother Jeff, that says, I'm a Christian. Oh, I'm a Christian, but you better leave them gays and lesbians alone. Just let them do what they want to do.
Come on.
Well, yeah, I'll say this. There probably ain't much that we can do because it's the Bible being fulfilled. But it doesn't say, give me the right brothers and sisters to just sit back and forget about praying for those people. Forget about loving those people. Because it might be our prayer, it might be our love that smacks them square in the eye and makes them turn around from that sin.
Right.
That's no more sin than going out and stealing something. Sin is a sin.
That's right.
I'm not upholding it one bit, but I'm so sick of turning on Facebook and seeing these so-called Christians want to literally bash them instead of just letting their belief be known and loving them.
Amen.
One of our members posted a post letting the belief be known and letting them know that she loved them. And then it got turned around to where she was the one being the judgmental one. She was the one being bashed. They love to throw up ascriptions, just not unless she be just. My Bible tells me I know them by the fruits that they bear. Whether it's homosexuality, whether it's drug addiction, alcoholism, fornication, anything. Sin is a sin. I will know them by the fruits they bear, is what the Word tells me.
Amen.
If you're bearing good fruit, then I know you're standing where you need to be with God. If you're bearing rotten and bruised fruit, honey, you better get to an altar somewhere.
Yeah.
Amen.
Because if you die in that state, you'll open up your eyes in hell.
Amen.
Hebrews 13:12. Wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered without the gate. Sis, if you'll come on up and get that song ready. Revelation 9:4. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads, meaning in their hearts and in their mind.
Amen.
In other words, if you're not sealed to the day of redemption with the blood of Jesus Christ for one, and the knowledge of his word in here, I'm sorry, but if the Lord comes back before you get those two things, you're going to wake up and you're going to open your eyes up in hell. Amen?
Amen.
I know this wasn't no shouting message, but I don't think you got to shout every single time you come into a church house.
Right.
See, amen. Pentecostal folk have got that backwards. A shout is because of victory. If you got something, a victory over the enemy, or something in your life that you've been praying for God to move in, and it happens, and it turns out for the good, then you've got victory, which means over the enemy, which means we should have the right to stand up and raise our hands, stomp our feet, run if we feel like running, and dance a while like David did.
Amen.
Do you realize that that's why David danced before the Lord when he danced with all his might? It's because of the fear. victory of bringing the ark back home where it belonged.
Amen.
Not because the music was running 500,000 miles a minute, or the beat of the drum allowed you to get that little toe stomp going.
Right.
Don't get me wrong, but I love to shout it next to the worship, next person. But just to shout because the music's right, it ain't the Holy Ghost, it's ADHD. It's a show of emotion. Somebody got mad about that on Facebook. Oh well. If a shoe fits, wear it. Too many folk getting offended over certain posts that is right and that's biblical, thinking it's about them. Well, the way I see it is like this. If you think a post is about you, probably it's not. But if a shoe fits, wear it. I'll probably get some messages over this one, but that's all right. Too many wishy-washy, whamby-pamby churches. They know they're going to shout before they even go to church. I seen a post the other day. Everybody come on out to the house. We're going to shout, stomp, and holler and have a good time. And I thought to myself, how do you know you're going to do that? How do you know before you even get there the Holy Ghost is going to show up in that manner? Right. He may show up in a still, calm manner that just sweeps over the whole church like a still, small voice or the sweet smell and savor of a rose.
Man.
Folk don't know what to do when the Holy Ghost show up like that. But that's all right. My message, main thing today is if you're not saved, if you're backslidden on the Lord, if you just don't know, you better get to an altar of prayer somewhere. It does not have to be in the church house like some preachers and churches tell you. Elijah made an altar out of stone in the middle of the forest or the town, whatever, when he went up against the prophet Baal and his 450 prophets. But you better get to an altar of prayer and you better earnestly give your heart and your life over to God. I don't want to, but this has come to my spirit, so I'm going to say it. And if you got the love of God in your life and the blood is applied, those of you that's got the spirit of rebellion, which is the form of witchcraft, you ain't got what you say you got.
Uh-oh.
Right, man.
Uh-oh.
Amen. I'll say it again.
Uh-oh.
Those of you who claim to be saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, and on your way to heaven, and you got a spirit of rebellion, you're no more than practicing witchcraft. Because rebellion is as the same as the sin of witchcraft, and God ain't nowhere in you. What's rebellion? Doing what you're told not to do, doing what you don't know God has asked you or told you or instructed you not to do, going against authority figures,
yep,
in the church,
yep, you do that, you also do so
in work,
yep,
home life. See, church don't want to preach on that no more because they know when they do, the pews are going to get a little skimpy and the money's going to dry up in their pocketbooks.
Yep.
Come on now. Ain't none of us worthy to be saved.
Amen.
Ain't none of us worthy to be preachers or teachers or evangelists or prophets.
But that grace of God.
But the grace of God, amen. It's the grace. See, in the Old Testament where I was preaching from, they lived under the law. But the day Christ was crucified and his blood came streaming down, he fulfilled the law, and we now fall under grace. Grace, God's grace is sufficient for you and me. But there's still guidelines. There's still rules and regulations.
Right.
That we must follow,
yep,
to be sanctified, set apart. The Bible tells us that when you get saved, we've got to come out from amongst them 18, you can't go to the movie theaters.
Clippers off.
I ain't gonna tell you you can't go to Gatlinburg or to the beach.
Well, you better not.
Go ahead.
I ain't gonna tell you you can't go to Nimrod, but there's a way you gotta conduct yourself when you're at them places.
Right.
Bible talks about being dressed modestly. What's being dressed modestly mean? Modest apparel. It means to make sure parts that need to be covered is covered. Doesn't mean you got to have hair plumb to the ground to where when you step, you pull your brains out. Or when you try to walk, you got to pull your dress halfway up.
Oh.
It means you keep private parts private.
Right. And in between.
Uh-huh.
Right.
Amen. Set the heart right and the rest to get right.
That's right.
Ooh, they're going to be some upset folk, but oh well, they can go pray. And I don't want to hear none of this. Well, the Bible said works out your own soul salvation with fear and trembling before the Lord. Yes, it does. But there's certain things that's set in stone now, brothers and sisters. It is what it is, and it ain't what you think it is.
Amen.
It also
the preacher's protecting other saints.
Amen.
It also says for the older women to teach the younger women and the older men to teach the younger men.
That's right. And that's the one thing that's wrong with the church
today.
Right. The older men and women are not teaching the younger men and women in the church like they should.
Or you got ones that won't live. That's right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm going to open up this altar. And if you got something to pray about, if you're saved and you know that you're saved and you know where you're at, then all you need to worry about is
helping somebody else.
Praying for God to come into someone else's life. I'm sure we all got lost loved ones.
Amen.
But listen to the words of this song. If you feel led to come and pray, the altar is open.
I know that I'm not worthy to call upon your name. All my life I've been a sinner, and for that I am ashamed. But I heard that you would listen, so I'm giving you my oh, I'm too unworthy, Lord, to come to you. Could you please go down to me?
Is everybody with you? Pray. Hold hands across the church.
Who could offer more than I? I promise I'd understand.
Father, in the name of Jesus,
I pray for you and God.
Lord, I just ask that you continue to bless your people.
I think I just did both. And I'm looking out.
Yes, God, in your overshadow, protect them during the school season, Father. We have all the angels open the doors of the witness, God, and the heart of God, of the children, of the strength of the teachers. Lord, we ask that you continue to build your church, God. Continue to bless your people in your church, Father. God, we ask that you give us souls for the labor, God. Lord, we love you. We are you. Magnified. Lord, indeed, a virgin take place, restoration, Father, in the house,
Lord.
You move with your people, God. You bless your people.
We haven't spoken.
Give us a vision, God. Give us a stirring in our spirit, Father. Give us an urgency, Lord God.
For us
to reach somebody, that will touch somebody's life, Lord. Lord, we love you, we honor you, we magnify you tonight, God. Lord, we just give you the praise, the glory, and the honor, God. Lord, in the name of Jesus, God, we pray together. Amen.
I know that there are others who could offer more.
Shielding us to Tennessee and all the way back, and I thank God for this church, and I thank God for the people in this church, because when I came here, I was broken, and I felt like I wasn't loved, but I know that I'm not here, and I thank God for that.
Bless you. And we thank this brother again for joining us. Appreciate
it. My pleasure. Thank you.
Yes. Brother Rusty, you want to dismiss us?
Lord, Father God, we thank you for this wonderful day that you've given us, and we thank you for the wonderful message that we've heard here today. Father God, we ask that you bless each and every one that is here with us, and go with them on their journey home, Lord, and bring them back at the appointed time. And this we ask in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen.